to get an equal share. And until you're giving him that, there'll be no peace. The brother's gonna work it out.
Brother's gonna work it out.
Brother's gonna work it all.
All.
I want to thank everyone for coming here today to address a very important issue. My name is Malik Russell. I'm the Communications Director for the Health Alliance for Violence Intervention, also known as the HAVI. Today we have a very amazing and timely discussion that will delve into the issue of gun violence, its impact over time, and also the cutting-edge solutions that many of the panelists will offer. This issue of gun violence has been one that has plagued black and brown communities for a long time. It's often been silent, and sometimes overlooked, and sometimes normalized. And what we want to do is be able to push back against those narratives and shift it into a way in which this issue is perceived as an emergency issue. Right now, I'd like to bring to the podium someone who is a key force in this issue of bringing peace to our communities. I'd like to introduce Julie Chavez Rodriguez, the Deputy Assistant to the President and the Director of the White House Office of Intergovernmental Affairs. Julie.
Well, thank you so much, Malik, for that introduction and for all of your work and the HAVI's work in bringing us together today. And good afternoon, everyone. It's really great to be with you all today. And also want to thank our partners that are part of our Community Violence Intervention Collaborative. We have some of them here on the panel, the Health Alliance for Violence Intervention, the Community-Based Public Safety Collective, as well as Fund Peace. And we're grateful that you all have joined us today to hear from these amazing panelists. In addition, I want to extend a special thank you to Mayor Scott from the City of Baltimore for his leadership in really showing the impact of what investing in our communities looks like and ways in which other cities can take up a similar charge. You know, President Biden sees gun violence as an epidemic, a real public health crisis. He spoke yesterday in New York City and just reiterated the fact that 40,000 lives are lost every year to gun violence. Every day, over 300 people are shot. And like so many other crises, black and brown communities suffer the heaviest burden. These shootings are disproportionately concentrated in neighborhoods harmed by past and present discrimination, segregation, redlining, disinvestment, mass incarceration, and concentrated poverty. The collective community trauma and loss of life in communities has devastating and often generational consequences for families, not to mention the cascading human, social, and economic costs that rip families and communities apart. But despite the challenges that we face, the good news is that we know there are community-based strategies that are having an impact and that are working to save lives. As many of you all know, investing in evidence-based community violence intervention is a key pillar of President Biden's holistic strategy to prevent and respond to gun crime, which is why last April, many of you all joined the President in the Rose Garden as he laid out his comprehensive strategy to combat gun violence and to invest in community-based public safety and community-based violence intervention strategies that we know have a proven track record to reduce violence and crime in our neighborhoods. But also, as Kay Bain, the head of community capacity development in New York City, told the president just yesterday when he visited some of their programming, that this work is not just about saving lives. It really is transforming individuals and communities from a place of living just to try to survive, to really a place where people can begin to create their future together and begin to build their path towards success. So for these reasons, the Biden-Harris administration has dedicated unprecedented funding to support organizations like these and leaders like Mayor Scott on the ground to ensure that we are building out complementary strategies to law enforcement in all of our communities. First, the Biden administration invested $350 billion in cities and communities and counties to be able to weather the impacts of the pandemic, and dedicated and ensured that some of these resources were going to efforts like these. We've seen several cities across the country, including Baltimore, which you'll hear about today, but also in Seattle, Washington, Buffalo, New York, Miami, Florida, Atlanta, Georgia, and states like New Jersey, Illinois, Michigan, and California continuing to invest American Rescue dollar funding in ensuring that local community-based public safety efforts are able to hire more intervention workers, expand their hospital-based violence intervention programs, build trauma recovery centers, and enhance services for survivors. Now, we established the Community Violence Intervention Collaborative, working with 16 jurisdictions across this country, to ensure that we could hone best practices that could be scaled in other cities and communities throughout the country. Working across subject matter experts who are providing training and technical assistance, and bringing together philanthropy and government to ensure that cities have the resources they need to innovate and to protect their communities. In addition to the American Rescue Plan funding, we're dedicating 26 federal funding programs to support community violence intervention. The president has called for a $5 billion investment as part of his Build Back Better Act, and we're continuing to look for new ways of supporting this work on the ground. And as I mentioned just yesterday, the president was able to join with community intervention leaders in Queens, New York at PS 111 to really see firsthand the critical work on the front lines to save lives every day, where trusted community members are coming together, working with those most likely to commit or be victims of gun violence, and ensuring that they have the skills and tools and resources to be able to access the opportunities available to them. We will continue to be strong federal partners, but the most important part of this work is happening on the ground in communities day in and day out, which is why I'm so grateful to be able to open up today's panel and to introduce so many of these key leaders that are really showing firsthand what healing the soul of our nation looks like in action. So thank you all again for inviting me to join you all today to open up this conversation. And with that, I would like to introduce our moderator, someone who has a distinguished career in putting forward her own series of really focusing and shining a spotlight on what it means to reimagine safety. So with that, I'd like to introduce Emafa Agawu to be able to join us today to moderate today's conversation. She joined the Post editorial board in 2020, where she produced the 7-part series that I mentioned, the multimedia series on reimagining safety. And if you haven't seen it, please check it out. It is one of the most profound windows into this work that I have seen really spotlighted at a national level. She's also a graduate of Yale and Oxford, and previously worked on technology policy at the Center for Security and Emerging Technology at New America. Emafa?
Thank you so much, and thanks everyone for joining us here today. This mask-free event brought to you by Rapid Tests, so we're all good there. Thanks for those opening remarks, Julie. As she said, I'm Emafa Ado-Agawu. I write for the Washington Post's opinion section, and I'm delighted to moderate today's discussion. We're here because we are failing too many of our communities, especially our communities of color. Many of us know the grim statistics. Homicide is the leading cause of death for Black boys and men, and the second leading cause of death for young Latino men. Young Black males between 15 and 34 make up just 2% of the population, but accounted for 37% of all gun homicides in 2019. And this violence takes a toll that is even greater than the lives cut tragically short. It affects entire communities. We know that the stress of living in a neighborhood plagued by violence literally enacts physiological changes in the body that can contribute to a range of poor health outcomes. We know that children perform worse on assessments right after a shock of local violence. This toll is unacceptable, and we're here because we know we can do better. So today we're going to talk about what better looks like and how we can get there. And I'm excited to welcome these distinguished panelists, each of whom brings a wealth of experience to the discussion. So we are joined by Greg Jackson, who serves as executive director of the Community Justice Action Fund. Greg is also a community organizer, political strategist, and issue advocate. Previously, he served as CJAF's National Advocacy Director, where he worked with communities, elected officials, community leaders, and impacted residents to advocate for proactive and preventive solutions to gun violence. Thanks for joining us, Greg. Next, we have Mayor Brandon Scott, who joins us from the city of Baltimore. I don't know if you know that I live in Baltimore, so you're my mayor, where he is the city's 52nd mayor. Before being elected mayor, Mayor Scott served as council president, where he developed and released the first ever city council president legislative agenda focused on building safer, stronger communities, cleaning up city government, investing in Baltimore's young people, and centering equity. We're really glad to have you, Mayor Scott.
Thank you.
Next, we have Fatima Lauren Dreyer, whose bio has not made it to my print. Oh, here we go. Fatima serves as executive director of the Health Alliance for Violence Intervention, the HAVI, and is a Posen Commonwealth Fund Fellow in Health Equity Leadership at the Yale School of Management. Before joining the HAVI, she was Deputy Director of Equal Justice USA, a national criminal justice organization. Fatima is a psychotherapist by training and a proud Phi Beta Kappa graduate of the University of Pennsylvania. Welcome, Fatima. And finally, I'm pleased to introduce Akila Sherrills, who wears many hats, so I won't read your whole bio, but he's currently co-founder and executive director of the Community-Based Public Safety Collective, and he's a community violence intervention collaborative advisor with Hyphen Partnerships. He has decades of experience of promoting community ownership of public safety and facilitating healing from violence in marginalized communities. Welcome, Akila. So thank you all for being here, and let's just dive in. By way of introduction, I'd love to ask you to tell us briefly what brought you to this work, and we'll start with Greg.
Yeah. Well, thanks again for having me. You know, what brought me to the work wasn't ambition or career choice. This was very personal for me. In April of 2013, I was shot as an innocent bystander here in Washington, D.C., and while I had a lot of passion for politics, I saw firsthand how big this issue is and how black men all over the country are being treated. You know, when I arrived at the hospital, I wasn't met by my doctors or nurses. I was met by investigators who interrogated me as I was fighting for my life. And despite that interaction, I survived, but I'll never forget my surgeon saying I only had about 26 minutes to live due to the blood loss. And I lost precious moments, you know, being criminalized as opposed to being seen as a victim. And while this was tough for me personally, every year over 100,000 people are shot or killed by gun violence. And so that means nearly a million people have been through experiences similar to mine. And since that moment when I became an advocate and activist in this work, I've seen multiple people die in my own neighborhood. Devon McNeil, who was the son of a violence interrupter in our community, was shot and killed at a 4th of July cookout. My mentee, Karan Brown, was shot and killed in front of a McDonald's over an argument with another 10-year-old. And Micaiah Wilson, who was down the street from me, who was shot and killed getting ice cream. And so the people who have been lost in this fight are way more than a statistic. These are people who meant a lot to me and to so many families and communities across the country. And I just vowed to use my story, but also to use some of my political background and wit to do something about it. And so at the Community Justice Action Fund, our whole mission is to reduce gun violence by empowering those who are closest to the pain and uplifting survivors with just a understanding that those who are closest to the pain have the best solutions on how we address and ultimately eradicate this crisis. So I'm excited to be here and thankful to be a part of this panel.
Thank you, Greg. And Mayor Scott, will you tell us about what brought you to this work?
Well, I always say that I was born into this work. I mean, I was born into a neighborhood in Baltimore that most people know for Preakness, but I know if you live in a neighborhood that for one day of the year is the center of the sports world and every other day of the year you're not even seen as human, it really changes you. I was 6 years old the first time I saw someone get shot and really decided at a very young age, because both my mom and dad just calmly looked at me when I said to them, why doesn't anybody care? Who's going to change it? And they said, if you wanted to change, you're going to have to do it. No one's coming to Park Heights. No one's coming to save us. We have to save ourselves. And much like Greg, when you had to duck those bullets and lose friends and go to funerals for people that you went to middle school with and high school with, folks that little kids that you saw grow up, people that you coached, it really changes you and changes you to understand that this is a disease, right? For me, I always tell folks in Baltimore, you probably hear it more than anybody else in the room, that we have been struggling with this cancer of gun violence in Baltimore longer than I've been alive. And if we're going to really impact and cure ourselves of the violence, then we have to look at it that way, and we have to treat it by having the people that are most impacted be the folks that are leading the work to make the healing happen. And that's really why I believe in this work and why we're never going to shy away from investing in this work. And I'm happy to be here today.
Thanks, Mayor Scott. I look forward to hearing more about that work later. Fatima?
Thank you, MFA. It's really no surprise to me that we share so many personal stories. This work, as you said, finds us. In my own life, you know, I had a father who was caught in that cycle of violence his entire life. He had a gun put to his head first when he was 16. By the time I was 4 years old, I had these memories of him coming home, blood all over his body, because he was caught in that life. And you know, I think that the images from my childhood, seeing loved ones go, family members, seeing loved ones in my neighborhood, they stay with you for years, really till this day. And I think my hope is, first by being trained as a psychotherapist, really thinking about what's at the root of this. It's trauma, it's intergenerational trauma. It's something that goes back so many generations in our communities, and we absolutely have to transform it. We have to heal it at its root. It's structural, right? It's the racism we experience, but it's also happening between us, and we gotta fix all of it. And so I lead the Health Alliance for Violence Intervention. We are a national organization that helps stand up hospital-based violence intervention programs to actually address some of the issues that Greg mentioned, right? People who are shot and go to the hospital and have no help, no one who really understands what they're going through, really training hospital workers to understand, but also empowering a whole workforce of violence intervention professionals who actually step in, are part of the staff that come at the hospital bedside, who understand what it's like, who are from the communities that are ravaged by violence and are there to actually provide care and support. We have, since 2009, been helping to stand up these programs. I'm proud to say we're in 85 cities across this country and progressively around the world. So this is an idea whose time has come, and the work is spreading. So thank you.
Thank you, Fatima. Akila?
Yes, and much like my colleagues, lived experience brought me to this work. I grew up in watching the Jordan housing projects in the 80s. And so I watched the crack cocaine trade blow through our neighborhood like Hurricane Katrina, uprooting families, just devastating the neighborhood. And I participated in what many social justice activists call the longest running war in the history of this country, urban street gang wars. Between 1983 and 2003, there were over 30,000 gang-related deaths in LA County. And it didn't include those permanently maimed or incarcerated for the rest of their life behind their participation. I mean, it's a public health epidemic, but because many of the perpetrators and victims were black and brown youth and young adults, our cries for help essentially fell on deaf ears. In 1992, I was instrumental with my brother and a group of friends in organizing a peace treaty that changed the quality of life in our neighborhood. In the first 2 years of the peace treaty, gang homicides dropped 44%. The city adopted our strategy, and years later, 2004 to 2014, we had 10 consecutive years in a row of decreases of homicide and overall violence. Now, I'm no novice to violence. I experienced it all my life. 16 years on the front line doing this work in terms of helping to address violence and mediate conflicts to peaceful resolve, but nothing prepared me for what happened in early 2003. My oldest son went to university, home on winter break, came home, went to a party, and was shot to death at the party. devastating, you know, and so, you know, far too often, you know, these type of tragic events happen in the community. Young people make knee-jerk decisions, you know, and I truly don't believe that people are their worst experiences, but I, you know, I don't just see the perpetrator as you know, their worst experience. I think that the things that we do, the things that have been done to us, they inform who we become. They don't define who we are. Mm. I mean, I don't condone what the young man did, but I do hold space for his healing. We just can't afford to just like lock anybody out, you know, of the system in terms of the healing services and the recovery services that individuals need. Mm. For the past few years, I've served as the director of the Newark Community Street Team. Was fortunate to be a part of a system that actually reduced violence. I mean, literally cut the homicide rate in half in the city of Newark, removed it from the top 10 most violent city lists, and am so fortunate to work with the White House Community Violence Intervention Collaborative. Now I'm working with 16 jurisdictions across the country, with many of my colleagues here, in terms of putting together strategies in these respective cities to build the capacity of community violence intervention organizations so that they actually serve as a complementary strategy to policing in terms of reducing violence and crime. So I'm just excited to be here and to engage this conversation with my colleagues about the future, you know, of public safety in this country.
Thank you all so much. What a stacked panel, right? So I think we're in a unique moment and we all feel it. The uprisings after George Floyd was murdered created new willingness in the mainstream to think and talk about new solutions. Some of these solutions are new, some of them aren't so new, but let's drill down into some of these solutions, and I'll start with you, Akilah. You have been doing this on the ground work for years. What are some things that are key to success that might be hard to understand from the outside, from people who aren't on the ground in the lived reality?
Yes. We talk about violence as a public health issue, and the impact of trauma that it has on the community. But I think a lot of times we talk about these things from a very clinical perspective. The public health frame says that those who are closest to the violence in the community should be equipped with the skills, the tools, and the resources to do the intervention, the prevention, and the treatment, right? And so our strategy has been to train residents. You know, non-traditional leaders, those who have been justice involved, those who are engaged with the conflict in the neighborhood, who have atoned for their wrongs, in the process of public safety, right? I know that traditionally you say public safety and people say police. And the reality is that police are only one aspect of the public safety system. We have to have an engaged citizenry that's trained. Like these high-risk interventionists and outreach workers and victims advocates, they don't just approach this work kind of willy-nilly, right? They approach this work as trained professionals in conflict resolution, mediation, de-escalation strategies. They operate with standard operating procedures and protocols. I mean, it is a real movement and career path for folks. You know, there's a pretty high threshold in terms of arrest and prosecution, right? So law enforcement is not always able to make an arrest and to be able to stop a conflict from happening. So you have to have folks in neighborhoods who have deep relationships with folks to be able to do that intervention and mediation and that long-term maintenance, because it's not a one-off, you know, in terms of, you know, you talk to someone who has these interpersonal conflicts and you know, we sit down at the table and it's over. You know, we have to engage, you know, the entire community and the entire ecosystem, you know, to be able to support folks in terms of bringing like comprehensive solution and resolve to neighborhoods. So, you know, I truly believe that it's about addressing like trauma, you know, in communities. First and foremost, we've allowed trauma to fester and to ripple in neighborhoods without like comprehensive strategies that address those things. I think that that residents trained as public safety professionals to see this work through a public health lens, through a trauma-informed approach, is the way that we're changing public safety in this country.
Yes, thank you for that, and especially for pulling out the idea of a public safety professional mm-hmm. who happens not to be law enforcement.
That's
I think
right.
That's something that's harder to understand outside of the work. Mayor Scott, I'd love to ask you about what's going on in Baltimore. what you're trying to do, who's involved, and any strategies you'd like to pull out.
Yeah, I think I will start just there. As the brother just said, this is an issue that you have to start to think about in a different way. And for us, and we're putting $50 million of our ARPA money, thank you, Julie, into community violence intervention work. And it's really about expanding that work, right? I've been in city government since 07, so I was there when we started our first safe streets, which are our community violence interruption sites. We have 4. We now have 10. Our intention now is to go from 10 to 30. But we're going to do that in a more responsible way. I think you heard it, and you hear it again and again. When you're growing these sites, there is a thing that's going too fast. You have to go right. You have to have the right people, take the right steps, build the right foundation, and you have to do it in the communities that are ripe and ready for that work. I think it's critical to know that. And when you're talking about these programs that we have, it's also very critical. I always tell folks, when I talk about my violence interrupters, I call them crime stoppers, because that's what they are, right? They interrupt each and every day. And I think we know that programs like Safe Streets work, and I always give a few examples. The neighborhood below mine, Bella Edison, I live in Frankfurt, a neighborhood in Baltimore City. Most years typically has 10, 15 homicides in it. Last year they had 0, right? And we attribute that to the partnership between our Safe Street site, the folks in the police department and community all working together. But the key that I think folks have to understand, who simply can't refuse to evolve their brains to understanding that people who used to actually shoot or stand on a corner with someone can have a conversation to stop something that a police officer just simply can't do.
That's right.
Refuse to understand that these are things that most of the time law enforcement wouldn't be able to interrupt. For example, there was an example highlighted recently in a profile in the Baltimore Sun about this Bella Edison Safe Street site, where a young man was riding one of the scooters that we all ride and bumped into a car. Some grown adult was about to shoot this young man, but the violence interrupters were able to intercede in that, right? Disputes over money. We are seeing violence, not just in Baltimore, but around the country, be driven by these small interpersonal disputes. Someone sent someone's girlfriend a message on Instagram, and boom, that person ends up being shot. When we have these organizations and people who can get to that credible messenger, and I always say that I grew up in Park Heights. I can go out on those corners and have a conversation that no other elected official can, right?
That's right.
But I still can't have the conversation that my friends in Safe Streets can have, because even though I was out there in that corner, I never had a gun. I never dealt drugs. I never shot someone. They can have that conversation. And now what we're trying to do is expand that work. We're talking about expanding our hospital-based response. We're talking about also taking that work to not just be a reactionary work, right? We're going to be using things. We have ShotSpotter in Baltimore, right? And everyone thinks about ShotSpotter as just this law enforcement tool, right? 80% in Baltimore of our ShotSpotter things have no associated 911 call. That means we are finding people bleeding who probably would die in many cases only because we have that technology. And many times there is no victim at all. What we're now going to be doing is deploying trauma-informed care folks to go out into those communities where we have these ShotSpotter alerts so that we can intercede, have our violence interrupters go out to see what's going on, making sure that we're talking about that complete healing for those communities, because we are talking about this disease and we have to attack it from every angle, every symptom. And it's really exciting for us. It's going to be a very a long building work, because you don't go from 0 to 100, right? You have to make every step. But we know that this work is going to be very, very impactful because we are partnering with respected community partners and individuals who do this work, who can go into places and have conversations with every facet of the community to make it happen.
Thanks for pulling out the privilege access that you have if you are truly embedded in the community and have trusted relationships with people, and that's so critical. Fatima, you are the leader of a national organization representing hospital violence intervention programs. Help us understand how that works, what it looks like, what success looks like.
Well, first, I'm so blown away by Mayor Scott and what he articulated as a vision for a city. This is really critical, because what I'm hearing in Mayor Scott's remarks is a true ecosystem of community violence intervention. And for many years in the violence intervention field, there were these fragmented programs. You'd hear about hospital-based violence intervention, you'd hear about street outreach here, and the minute you call it a program, people think, okay, you know, it's something that helps, you know, these folks here. Instead of thinking about it as a strategy, as a targeted strategy that can transform communities. That's what they were designed to do. And so hospital-based violence intervention is one component of an entire strategy. And what it does is it allows us to leverage a teachable moment. When people are shot, when they're harmed and they go to the hospital, there is a moment. There's a moment that where they're beginning to think about things. Retaliation plans are getting hatched, right? The waiting rooms often are places, they become ground zero for a whole host of fear and anxiety and anger. And before these programs existed, hospital staff would simply address the physical wounds. There might be law enforcement there in hospitals doing investigative work. And then folks are discharged and sent right back into the same community from where they came.
That's right.
That can't work. It doesn't work. The opportunity in the hospital to leverage these credible messengers, right? They are hired staff, right? They're in their hospital, or there's a partnership between the hospital and a community-based organization. But those credible messengers have a badge. They're able to go bedside and speak directly to patients. Talk to them with that lived experience about where they are, what their needs are. Think about a safety plan. Think about where we can find resources to get them relocated, find them housing, find them work, put them in a training program, whatever it is that they need. Sometimes it's as simple as, let's get an ID for you so you can have access to these services. Sometimes it's that simple. And then our credible messengers follow people after their discharge. So it's not just at the hospital. They follow them into their communities, visit them regularly. These are the models we're referring to. And when it works best, they're reaching out to their street interrupter brothers and sisters, right, who are doing work mediating disputes. They're connecting to the victim service advocates. They're connected to the trauma recovery. They're connected to a whole ecosystem, and they're all communicating with one another. That, I think, is what's so incredibly powerful about this. But the hospital is critical because many people, even if they're not calling 911 to get to the hospital, some people will just drop people off at the hospital, right? They'll just throw them in the back of their car and drop them off in front. So the hospital is taking a lot of the folks who are connected to this the violence that's happening, and it's a critical opportunity to intervene.
Thanks for sharing that, and especially for pulling out the shift from programmatic thinking, one-off programs, to a whole ecosystem that's connected. That's really powerful. Greg, just like anything else, not all gun violence intervention efforts are created equal. I'd love to hear, in your view, what are the conditions for success, for that ecosystem to really thrive?
Yeah, and I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, you know, we come at this from an advocacy perspective. We were founded when we realized that the way that policy organizations and advocacy organizations looked at the crisis of violence was overlooking Black and brown communities and what was happening in our inner cities. And so we took it on as a charge to really push and advocate for the solutions that are being laid out here. And we think that the number one thing that's needed for success, sadly, is resources. Many of these organizations that are saving lives, that are risking their lives, and are frankly reducing violence every day, are being run off of people's what's coming out of their pockets. You know, I know people who have been in this 30 years have took out multiple mortgages on their home just to keep their nonprofit afloat. A leader in Austin, Texas, who's doing violence intervention, is an electrician by day and violence interrupter by evening. And these are programs that we know are critical in order to reduce the cycle of violence. And so number one for us has been fighting for these resources. We came together and built multiple coalitions. The Fund Peace Campaign, the Invest in Us Coalition, demanded that the President and Congress look at federal funding and resources to invest in these efforts, but also fought for states and cities to step up to the plate, knowing that the same old law enforcement and incarceral approaches, we're going to continue to fall short. And the main reason we know they fall short is from our perspective, is because of the way that violence is showing up in our communities. As Mayor Scott shared, most of these violent moments are interpersonal conflicts, and they're not necessarily connected to crime. The Violence Policy Center does an annual report on black homicide, and they found that 68% of homicides in the black community are not connected to another felony. And so if all we're applying are crime control strategies, then we're only approaching 30% of the incidents before the bullet is already fired. And so we strongly believe that we have to invest in these proactive programs, this proactive system that looks at prioritizing victims, intervening conflicts before they happen, working with those who are most at risk, and really addressing the risk factors that lead to that moment that gets out of hand. I also think a key thing for these efforts to be successful is that it's part of a larger strategy that pulls in all parts of government, whether that's Department of Employment Services, whether that's Health and Human Services, whether that is housing authorities. It takes everyone to be invested in these people and in these communities to be successful. And that's why we're extremely excited that the CDC director this year was the first CDC director in history to name this as a public health crisis and name this as a priority beyond just what we've been seeing from the Department of Justice. And so I think those two components are the foundation: resources, investment, and then really pulling in entire government to be a part of the strategy to reduce violence.
I'd like to piggyback off of Greg's incredible point about the power of resources. And we actually have a slide on the incredible story of Oakland, California. I think it is the best example we have to date of actually what Mayor Scott is endeavoring to do in Baltimore City. This is next slide. It's actually a city in which the residents voted to tax themselves, Measure Z, voted to tax themselves to fund both community violence intervention and police right together as part of one ecosystem. And they created a coordinated strategy and scaled it with consistent funding, and found after 6 years a 50% reduction in violence in Oakland. I mean, a staggering number that they sustained up through the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And what happened in the pandemic, those incredible violence interrupters, violence intervention specialists, the professionals were all told to stay home because of COVID, and we saw spikes. We saw a 30% spike in violence across the nation. And particularly in Oakland, it was tragic because if you looked at the first few months of 2020, right before the pandemic hit, they were already seeing lower numbers than the same time last year. So this work is remarkably powerful when fully deployed. And it took policy, it took consistent resources over time, it took that scaled approach that Mayor Scott referred to. They didn't do it all at once, and they're all communicating with one another, they're coordinating their efforts. Every city needs a plan like this. Every city needs the resources to support this. That's where the power is coordinating and ensuring that you're empowering residents, right? Empowering those who understand and are credible in this work to actually get the work done.
I just want to just add one thing, and it's a very critical point, and especially for leaders of cities and states too. This summer, I released the city's first ever comprehensive violence prevention plan, because it is about every single agency, right? And I think folks, we get into this thing where people still, when they say violence, they think police only, right? No, it's not, right? We know it's violence interrupters, but it's also our departments of public works, right? Of course, more violence is going to happen in a neighborhood where alleys are blocked with trash and couches. Transportation, if street lights are out and things, all of these things, if our rec centers are not open, all of these things play a part in what we are doing throughout our violence prevention plan, is talk about the responsibility of every single city employee. Every agency will be held, our health department and others will be held responsible for how they are working to reduce violence in Baltimore. And I think that we have to do that around the country in order for us to truly see us deal with this issue.
That's helpful, yeah. Go ahead.
To just make a quick comment also, just in terms of in Newark in 2020, you know, specifically to Fatima's point, the mayor deemed the Newark community street team and high interventionists essential workers at the onset of the pandemic. And because those individuals had an opportunity to go out and engage residents, utilizing that relationship-based approach, sharing information about COVID, but also intervening and mediating conflicts, our officers in 2020 didn't fire their revolvers, not once. You know, and while violence spiked all across the country in 2020, our numbers remained flat from 2019 to 2020. We had 51 homicides, which was a 60-year low in Newark. We had a 51 homicides, still too many homicides, right? But I think also it speaks to some of the training and support that has to go for officers, right? Because our officers don't always fully show up fully rooted in their humanity, because we put so much responsibility on them to be coaches and teachers and therapists.
Everything.
And, you know, and so they don't get the type of healing and recovery services that they need in order to be present in terms of the work. So, you know, Newark implemented a program that was started by EJUSA, actually by Fatima before she went over to the HAVI, called Trauma to Trust, in which residents and law enforcement together engaged in conversations around unpacking their personal trauma, also historical traumas, and it improved relationships, you know? And as a result, I think something like 50% of officers who participated in the training, and over like 300 officers are now going through the training, had, you know, like less disciplinary problems and actions that happened in the city. So it's important, right, that we address trauma not just on a community level, but also for our officers, because they're afraid to talk about in within cop culture to talk about the trauma that they experience, because they will get rubber gunned and desked, you know, by even speaking about it. And so we want to also just encourage, you know, more investment and training for healing services and recovery services for cops, because we need them to show up firmly rooted in their humanity when they're providing services to the public.
So we've been talking about this ecosystem of safety and the different actors who need to contribute, and we've been talking some about law enforcement's role, and I'd like to ask each of you, maybe starting with Greg, how you think about law enforcement's role in this ecosystem of safety now, in the near term, and perhaps in an ideal future. Greg?
Yeah. I think from our perspective, we see that law enforcement has a role to play, but this is a public health crisis, first and foremost. And if we're not taking a public health approach, then we're missing what's happening to our community right now. And so we strongly believe that there's kind of three elements of this work that needs to happen. Intervention work that targets and deals with those who have already been exposed to violence and are most at risk to violence. Addressing the risk factors that leads to someone being exposed to violence or acting out violently. And then lastly, shifting the institutions and reforming the institutions and root causes that create those risk factors that ultimately lead to violence. And while law enforcement plays a great role on the reactive side, all of that proactive work needs to happen if we truly want to end gun violence once and for all. You know, I spent part of my childhood living in rural America, where we had two police officers, right? And so we do believe that there is a world where communities can be safe, can be healthy, can be happy, can live positive lives without having a police officer on every block. And in so many communities across the country, Americans are experiencing that. And so we truly believe that if we attack this public health crisis the way that we know it's playing out in our communities, we can see a world where law enforcement aren't being held accountable to solve this problem alone.
Yeah, and I think I agree with everything Greg said, but it's also, for me, this work goes hand in hand, and I'll give you an example of it for us. We just started our group violence reduction strategy, which is a both approach, right? Where we're gonna be bringing folks in and telling them, look, we know who you are, we've identified who you are, we want you to have this opportunity to change your life so that you don't end up being the victim or the perpetrator of this violence. But once we go through that, and if they don't, that's when the law enforcement side comes in. That's where we should be focusing on those efforts. Yes, every day there's going to be a role for our police officers, especially on things when we think about, you know, for us, for me, one of the things I think about consistently is how do we bring those people in who need to be held accountable. not throwing people away forever, right? But when you're talking about serving warrants, people who need to be pulled off the streets because they have shot somebody's mother, grandmother, whoever, that's the role for our law enforcement officers. But what we cannot continue to do is make them responsible for everything. Someone shouldn't be able to wake up and call 911 and say, well, my kid doesn't want to go to school, and we send a police officer. That's not their job. Someone shouldn't be able to, and this is a true story, you can see it on a PBS documentary about Baltimore, to call 911 and a police officer could come barreling down the street only for the woman to say, my husband's cheating on Facebook, can we show you how to stop this? That's not what their job is supposed to be, right? We have to change the mindset that police officers have to respond to everything, because when you ask people, when you do polling and say, what do you want your police officers focus on? They're gonna say violent crime. But the reality is what they say, what we say with our fingers when we dial 911, for us, where 80% of their time is spent on non-emergency, we're saying the exact opposite. And it's gonna take leadership to change that culture, to make people mad, to say no more. We're diverting these calls away to the folks that it needs to be, right? And I always say, in Baltimore, ironically, the first conversation that I had about 911 diversion came with a police officer. Happened to be a gentleman that I played on a flag football team with, who was the commander of the district in which Johns Hopkins Hospital sits. And he just said to me very calmly, he said, Brandon, this doesn't make any sense. He says, I have the number one hospital in the world in my district. Why am I sending police officers out to these calls? It makes no sense. And we're now starting that and evolving our way of thinking, because we can no longer operate that way. It's not going to lead for us to have a sustainable model in reducing crime. So they have their focus and where their focus should be, but we also have to keep going and evolving the way that we think. It's multiple pieces to this puzzle, but it is going to create a big cultural change that is not going to be easy, because people have got accustomed to dialing 911 for any and everything and seeing police. We have to build that into our folks and really have leaders who are unafraid to make that change.
Thank you. Fatima?
You know, it's really interesting, Akila referenced some of the work I did in previous life, thinking about trauma. My brother is a police officer, and before that he was an educator. And when he decided to make that switch in his community, I was terrified. I said, why on earth would you switch being a teacher to a police officer? Oh my God. And he said, you know, if we don't have people who think like me in those institutions, when our people are doing things that we know are rooted in trauma and structural racism, right? If we don't have people like me out there to understand and humanize them and make decisions that actually can transform their lives at a moment they're in crisis, then everything else we try to do won't work. And I think that is the opportunity. If we can reimagine the footprint of policing, it can be leveraged in this way. I've spoken to police departments across this country, and there are a couple things, right? One, they don't want police-involved shootings either, right? Like, there's not a single department that says, you know what, we want to make sure, right? That's point one. The second is, I think that we have an opportunity to really demonstrate the power of this ecosystem. And when law enforcement experience the partnership that is available in this coordinated way, they want it. They want more of it. They want to see it scale. They want the partnership. And I think, you know, and Akila says a lot, it's a complementary strategy. When I talk to our violence intervention, our peace workers, right, our violence intervention specialists, the ones who are in the name of thinking about transformation communities, people who have been in and out of prison themselves and have been impacted by violence, and we talk to them, what do you think about law enforcement? And they say, listen, we've been in the streets, we've had altercations with law enforcement, we understand that there are a lot of problems that need to get solved,
but not a single violence intervention specialist has said that they want to completely get rid of police. They say we have to work, we have to figure it out, right? It's something we have to figure out. And I think that is a courageous position to have.
That's right.
To imagine a way forward where we actually work together. It is much easier to be divided, and we all lose when we're divided. It is far more courageous to imagine a world where we could actually handle this issue and heal trauma together. And I actually believe we can. And I want law enforcement to be involved. I want their trauma to be healed. I want them, their footprint to be different, right? I want when people think about violence in communities to think about a whole range of actors who can take some time and to actually address the issue. But they're part of that, those stakeholders.
I just want to add something to that. I think is important to note. When we're talking about these instances where people think that having a police officer will prevent it, right? And most of the time it's not. I can speak to it from personal experience and about the total of the healing and not throwing people away. When I was robbed in my quiet neighborhood in Northeast Baltimore, there would have never been a reason for a police officer to be out in front of my building when it happened. And the truth is that the healing for that didn't come until 10 years after it happened.
Yes.
Never went to court, never got to see him, until the young man actually reached out to me via his lawyer to say he wanted to sit down. And I went to see him in prison. And him and I literally had this 2.5-hour session where we talked about how the system essentially failed both of us, me and him, right? They never allowed us to heal. They never allowed him really to grow. He was 16 years old when it happened. You know, he was now 26 years old, right? I was 33 or 36 or something like that when it happened, right? I wasn't the same person I was, so surely he wasn't. And what we were able to do is then plot a course where we could have that healing, right? And I was actually able to work to get him released from prison early, because the truth is that he shouldn't have been in there that long. I thought he was out, right? No one asked me if I thought he should stay in there for 10 years. They made decisions for me along the way and didn't allow me, the victim, to have that healing, because I don't want to throw away a young man's life. I want him to be able to be in a place where we can rehabilitate him and get him back out to being with his family and his community.
Powerful, man. George Floyd was an inflection point in this country, as you said. You know, and I think that it signaled to us that no longer should we see law enforcement as this single, like, kind of ubiquitous point of contact for safety in our respective communities. You know, reimagining public safety is not just about more procedural justice trainings and de-escalation strategies for cops. It's also about investing in comprehensive, community-based public safety and community-led solutions. The data says that only 2%, of the population is actually producing like about 80-90% of the harm in communities. So I think that the future of law enforcement is a targeted deterrence strategy, and there are great models that exist out there. You know, I'm a huge fan of LAPD's Community Safety Partnership, which is a targeted deterrence strategy in the neighborhood. These cops aren't just regular officers. They were elevated and given more investment and training to sergeants. They're deployed in neighborhoods where they actually are more social workers than cops. You know, and as a result of their work, like in the projects that I grew up in Jordan Downs, we had 2 consecutive years in a row with no shootings, with no homicides, which was unprecedented. Now the thing is that, like, a lot of times, law enforcement takes all the credit because the community-based organizations don't have the infrastructure, to be able to document, but we have it now, right? We didn't have it back then, but we can now document, through CRM systems like Apricot, where we document every intervention and mediation, and report on it, right? Because we're like, hey, we know that this evidence-based or anecdotal like kind of support is important in terms of creating that balance. The other thing that I would say is that probably 2 of the most dehumanized groups in the country are black men and cops. you know. And I ain't getting into the trauma Olympics. I know that people have suffered heavy, right? But you know, like for instance in Newark, you know, history, you know, we have a consent decree that we're working through right now. There's a long history of cops, you know, like harming people in the neighborhood, right? And so a new rookie officer joins the force, as your brother has. They put on that uniform and they inherit the whole history of everything that, that folks who were the bad seeds had done to folks in the neighborhood, right? And so I think that it's an opportunity to really unpack the trauma again. People aren't their experiences. We're not the things that we have done. We're not the things that have been done to us. These things are actually only informing who we become. They don't define who we are. And I think that we're at a place in history where I think that there's been space made in people's imagination to really to think differently about public safety and policing. And you know, I'm just, you know, excited that the Biden administration, you know, has really elevated this conversation in a way that I've been doing this work for 30 years on the ground, in the trenches, on the front line. And so believe me, when folks saw, you know, us at the White House sitting in the Rose Garden and heard the president, the attorney general and the VP say that law enforcement is not the only solution to safety, and that safety is a shared strategy. You know, I was sitting next to Mayor Baraka and he was like, man, he was like, did you hear that? He was like, I thought I would never hear this in my lifetime.
Yeah, that's
right? Because we've known each other for 20 years. I helped the mayor, I mean, when he was the principal at Central High School, we organized a peace treaty in Newark in 2004, because Grape Street, my neighborhood, was the biggest Crip gang in the city of Newark and in the state of New Jersey. You know, so this phenomenon of like kind of youth organizations and urban street gang culture has touched multiple communities across the country, right? And I think that the power of the White House utilizing its convening power to bring people together and engage in these types of dialogues and conversations is revolutionary.
Thanks for that. Julie mentioned these historic investments from the Biden-Harris administration. I'd like to talk a little bit more about these national efforts. Greg, what does it look like for these investments to find their way into the hands of community members? What would you like to see?
Well, I think we've kind of really dove deep into the different solutions that exist. I think what's most important to acknowledge and to reiterate is that it requires a system of CBI organizations in order to effectively address violence in our communities. And so what we are fighting for now is frankly federal, state, local, county, and cities to push out these resources by, one, understanding what these models are, but really striving to resource an entire system per city that's attacking this issue of violence. But step one is committing to the resources. Step two is understanding the models and the strategy. And then step three is getting those funds to those folks who are doing it best. Thankfully, there are entities like the CVI Collaborative, like the Fund Peace Coalition, and so many organizations that are out here helping the groups on the ground strengthen their capacity and scale. But it also requires some real education at the top from leaders at the government, county, and local levels. And so we think if we can get that education at the top, if there's strong advocacy organizations like ours to hold them accountable all the way through all of that. But most importantly, we have groups on the ground that are part of a broader system and ready to scale and ready to grow with these resources, that we can do this effectively. But it will take work. Thankfully, we have a few great models to point to, the city of Baltimore being one, and cities all over the country that are doing this the right way. And we're hoping that can mentor and coach other cities. I was joking with the mayor earlier. I was like, I hope you're ready for a lot of Zoom calls because there's a lot of cities like Fayetteville, North Carolina, you know, the state of Tennessee, places that are stepping into this world to address these crises for the first time, but don't have the wealth of knowledge or lived experiences like Mayor Scott. And so we think that that's going to be really important. We're looking forward to the White House being real big leaders in that area and convening and managing and helping to connect the dots for our public officials and leaders. But we do think it can be done if that commitment from all of us is played out.
Well, Mayor Scott, let's talk about the White House Community Violence Intervention Collaboration. Baltimore is one of 16 jurisdictions. what's going on? How's it going?
For us, it's going great. And actually, I'm understanding this because Fatima sitting next to me actually have it, and it says growing Baltimore's CVI ecosystem. That's literally what we're doing and working with the partnership to do. And for us, it's about a really growing. We've had this in Baltimore for a long time, right? But now we want to grow it into the next mile. It's actually, when I hired my director of the Mayor's Office of Neighborhood Safety Engagement, Shantae Jackson, the first thing that I said, you have to look at our violence intervention work and see, how do we change it? How do we grow? How do we evolve? Because we can't do today in 2020 at that point what we were doing in 2008. Everything is different. And to have a partner, and I will say for me, and Julie was sitting next to me when we were in the White House meeting with President Biden, and he actually uttered the words that gun violence is a public health issue. I almost fainted,
yes.
Right? Because I thought I would never hear that come out of the mouth of a president. And it means so much. It's a small thing, but to so many people who've been doing this work for decades like yourself, who are out there on the front lines, it signaled a change that we are no longer considered a program. We're no longer something that's just, oh, this little fun thing that we put in the budget to keep these people quiet. We're now seen as a part of the true solution to an issue that we've been ignoring. So in this collaborative, working with other cities, helping other folks, which we'll do, I would prefer for it not to be on Zoom, but I understand, but really learning the best practices from across the country, making sure that everyone is taking those steps, because I think that's something that I'm gonna harp on again, because if we don't get it right, we know who they are. There are some people going to say, see, this is why we should have never done this in the first place. So we cannot make any missteps. That's a lot of pressure, right? But we know pressure makes diamonds. And we have to make sure that we're doing it right this time, because we can prove to them. We have the data already. And now we can take that data up another notch in cities around the country to say, you can no longer ignore the fact that these public health, community-based approaches work to solving this issue.
Fatima and Akilah, I'd love for you to weigh in on these questions of scale, because as we've heard, so much of this work relies on talented people who have long-time trusting relationships that can't necessarily be grown overnight. So what's the right way to think about how national support can support the scaling of local ecosystems of safety?
I think it's important to acknowledge the role that national organizations play in supporting scale. So the Community Violence Intervention Collaborative, or CIVIC, is comprised of four national organizations: the Community-Based Public Safety Collective, the Health Alliance for Violence Intervention, Cities United, which works with mayors, and the National Institute for Criminal Justice Reform, Nick Jr., which focuses on this gun violence reduction strategy Mayor Scott referred to earlier. And these are organizations that can really help support groups that are local understand and actually facilitate that peer learning across different sites, support with training, and actually help build the model, right? Every ecosystem has to be customized, right, to what's happening locally, absolutely. So we don't say you just kind of carte blanche takes what works in Newark right. and transport it to Baton Rouge and expect it to all work exactly the same, no. But you take the scaffolding, you take the infrastructure, you get the components right, and you're able to transfer that knowledge base and then have an opportunity to work with people locally to customize. That's the winning combination. Once you get there, I think it's really critical to galvanize every partner. Partnerships take work, right? So even when there's urgency, you either have the case where people are apathetic, right? They're not really paying attention to the issue. Or you have people who are so excited, they think that they get results in the next week, right? Which is not the case either. Partnerships take time, training takes time, and getting the data right. You have to know where to target the efforts. You have to make sure people know what the data is and can draw their attention to those neighborhoods that need it. You have to make sure people one misconception people have is that they assume if they just focus on young people that they'll address violence, right? And it's a big misconception. It's not the case. We always want, we care about youth development programs, right? We want that to happen. So I'm not at all saying that youth development isn't important. But if you look at the data, city by city, who is actually taking the lion's share of violence? First of all, it's a very few, it's a small concentration of people. It's not everyone everywhere. It is a small number of people. That's point one. The second is, you could look at the age ranges, and in some cities, the ages range from, let's say, 35 to 40, right?
Or 31
right,
30,
right. So if you were only focused or targeting young people, you would miss the actual group that in the near term is actually harming us. Others and caught in that cycle. Again, we say caught in the cycle because many of the people who go and harm have been harmed themselves and exposed to violence in their communities. So how do we get them out of that cycle? We got to know where they are. We got to find them. All of that takes work. And when you have the targeted resources, the political will, when you have partnerships in place, when you have the right people hired, it can all work. It can all work very seamlessly together. And all of that takes time. You know, when I use the analogy of a building, right? When you hear the big announcement, you know, the mayor goes out and there's the hard hats and they've got the shovel and they're like, you know, we're gonna build this building. No one expects the skyscraper to show up in the next day or week or month.
I wouldn't be too sure about that.
Yeah. Maybe some people, might expect it, but those that I think know a little bit about how buildings are built know that it takes time, right? And so I think the same kind of patience, urgency, right? Urgency, the reality of the investment that's needed, right? Mayor Scott with a $50 million investment is getting real close, right? Like that is the kind of scale investment you would need. But then you need the patience to actually allow the work to work, so.
Yeah, and I would just add that in terms of the White House Community Violence Intervention Collaborative, so we're taking a real systematic approach to building the capacity of individuals and the organizations in the community. So the 16 jurisdictions are broken up into four cohorts. Each one of the national TTA providers are leading in those respective cities. We're going in and doing high-level landscape analysis. We're then doing strength-based assessments of those CBI organizations that the cities give us to as a warm handoff. We're meeting one-on-one with the organization. We're surveying their boots on the ground because we want to know, you know, how, you know, the actual interventionists who are doing the work in the field, like how are they feeling? Do they feel like they have the capacity to do the work? How are they managing their trauma? Which is a really important thing because, you know, people bring their total selves to this work. And then, you know, that strength-based assessment that looks at their programmatic and fiscal infrastructure, we're then designing like kind of TTA plans. As Fatima said, they're place-based strategies. So we look at, okay, how do we then bring in subject matter experts to help you with workforce development? You know, building systems around transformational education, addressing some of, you know, the real issues that some of our folks have. Like, you know, it's a high level of functional illiteracy in communities and stuff, but it doesn't mean that people aren't effective at doing their work. You know, so we have to build off of people's lived experience and not, you know, judge them, you know, by some of the shortcomings, right? And so it's, you know, as we're building out like infrastructure in these cities, philanthropy then plays a really strategic role because we know that, you know, federal government, you know, city government, there's, you know, rules and regulations and everything to being able to access those dollars. So philanthropy's role has been to seed, you know, possibility until we can actually have enough infrastructure where we can bring in public dollars to be able to, you know, sustain this work over the long haul. So peer exchanges, we're doing national peer exchanges right now. You know, we got people coming from Baton Rouge and going to Miami, people from Miami going to Baltimore, people from Baltimore going to Newark, you know, so that we're looking at all of our respective strategies and that we're learning from each other, but also building camaraderie across the movement. A lot of us, we all know each other in the movement, you know. As Greg said, you know, Fund Peace, Invest in Us, the White House Collaborative, we meet every month. talk about strategy, talk about advocacy, how we can, you know, work together, in, you know, with electeds in cities, how we identify, you know, Pookie and them on the ground, because they have to buy in and support this work in order for it to work as well. And so I think that, you know, philanthropy, again, has played such a strategic role in this conversation and in this relationship, because they we also need them to put that money up so that we can, so that they can fund those mini grants. Because as our organizations develop, you know, some of them are already ready and they're ready to apply for, you know, for federal dollars to get that sustainable long-term funding. But some of our organizations are in that infancy stage. They might get a grant, you know, from the mayor's office, get, you know, $150,000 grant, and they can't make payroll because they don't have 3 months, you know, because it's a fee for service grant, right? They don't have dollars in the bank to be able to meet payroll. And so through the White House Collaborative, the you know, philanthropy then comes in and says, okay, here's, you know, through the TTA provider, of course, here's you know, $25,000 to cover payroll for the next 3 months while you get your systems in place to be able to access these dollars. And so this is like this you know, all hands on deck. That we're building this you know, the capacity of the individuals, the organizations, you know, as well as the cities and law enforcement in partnership with this ecosystem of safety.
I just got to say this. I think that they just said it so eloquently. I think folks really need to understand that there are folks who just think like, oh, well, the president announced this, he gave all this money, boom, violence is going to stop.
Right.
No, right? You have to build these things from the ground up. You actually have to know who the people are. And I'll give a quick example. When we went through our data analysis for our group violence reduction strategy, we found out that it was older folks, you know, 30, 31 years old, who we should be focused on. Well, there were no social programs. There were no housing, no GED, no substance abuse things. Focus on middle-aged folks in Baltimore because everything's been hyper-youth-focused. We have to build that up. So we need folks to understand that cities are not ignoring or not being urgent about this issue. They're being very urgent, but also very responsible because they have to build something that didn't exist before we were able to do this.
That's right.
It's such a good point about being grounded in the reality of each city. Yep. I'm going to open up to questions in a minute, but one more before. Moving to a kind of bigger picture, as Julie mentioned, we're not just talking about reducing violence, we're talking about actively building strong and safe communities, vibrant communities. So I'd like to ask each of you, starting with Greg, what else needs to be on the agenda locally and nationally to deliver on this promise of stronger, safer, more vibrant communities?
Yeah, I mean, we strongly believe that you know, again, there's kind of three major parts to this. There's intervening violence as it's happening. There's attacking the risk factors that lead to violence. And then really pushing for bold policy change that reforms and refines the root causes of violence. And by root causes, we mean things like housing instability, economic opportunity, educational equality, all of that we know fuels the risk factors that ultimately lead to violence. And so we actually see this step around investing in CVI and building this world out as phase one of what we're trying to do ultimately to help our communities, both short and long term. I mean, unfortunately, you know, we're in a world where there are more firearms than there are people in this country. And so we have to figure out how can we save and support those who have already been exposed and already have access, but then build out long-term strategies to address it. I also will you know, uplifted there, even as much as we're doing in the CVI space, there still needs to be more work done to end gender-based violence in our country. Violence against women, women-on-women violence, and violence against those of the LGBTQ community in our communities has been surging alongside of this interpersonal homicide problem that we're seeing. And so that's something that we're fighting for and advocating for. There's an amazing piece of legislation we're endorsing, the Protect Black Women and Girls Act in Congress that we're advocating for. And we want to see more of those specific efforts duplicated across the country. I think the only other big thing that I will share is that as much as we're working on interpersonal conflict and homicides, we can't forget that with the surge of firearms that are being purchased, accidental shootings and violence against youth is going to be a real problem and is a growing problem. And so we are working on efforts to help educate our communities on responsible gun ownership, to address accidental shootings, but also to address the factors that lead to those types of incidents or suicide. And a lot of those problems that have happened and showed up in our country broadly to those who've been impacted by gun violence are now starting to spike within Black and brown communities as well. And so there's a lot more to do, but we're really encouraged by what we're seeing this year and frankly with the leadership of the White House and the president to jumpstart a lot of these efforts.
Mayor Scott, what else should be on the agenda?
Yeah, I think that Greg just laid it out. And for me, I always come from this from a Baltimore perspective as the first city to really, and where a racial redlining was weaponized in the building that I call home in my office every day, right? We have to understand that these issues that happen in our neighborhoods are as a result of decades and decades and decades of purposeful, in many cases, disinvestment into these communities, right? From an educational standpoint, from a health standpoint, from the jobs opportunities, all of these things relate directly to what we're seeing in violence. So a good start would be for Congress to pass Build Back Better. I think that would be a great start for us, right?
Yeah, it's a huge
just a small thing, right? And I think a lot of folks are afraid of Build Back Better because of what it's talking about. These they want to look at it as social programs, but it's really about investing in people. We have to. I am ecstatic that we got an infrastructure package passed, but we also have to invest in people and communities so that through a lens of equity, so that we can start to rebuild communities in a way that will allow us to not have folks have to go down this path. Because people didn't just choose to be born poor and have, you know, live in a drug-infested neighborhood or not have schools that have air conditioning. I didn't choose that, right? Yeah. I didn't choose that. I was born into that. And in fact, me being born into that in Northwest Baltimore was better than what my dad and mom were born into in rural Virginia and North Carolina, right? But we have to take that the next step in investing in our people and those issues that are not as easy as to solve, because you can't just fix a community by fixing a bridge. And in all honesty, you can't fix it by just fixing a school. You know, I get in trouble. Baltimore has, over the past few years, built or renovated more new schools than any city in the country. But I always tell folks that that's not just it, because we have to build better families. Because if Jonathan is still going home and he, at 11 or 12 years old, is responsible for every other young person in that household, we're still failing him. And that's what we have to do in order for us to take this to the next level.
Thanks.
I've so enjoyed this panel. I want to build off my colleague's remarks. You know, Greg, what you said about that three-pronged strategy, we share, of course. You know, we've got to focus on intervention. We have to ensure that we're beginning to understand the ecosystem, that coordination, and systems change. That's critically important. But all of that relies on leadership and a pipeline of leadership. When we talk about credible messengers, they are heroes in our community. What they're able to do, their leadership needs to be honored. But I'm also talking about the leaders of Director Rodriguez and Susan Rice, Ambassador Rice in the White House, the leadership in our president, our vice president, who had a vision. This president is one who, on the campaign trail, was talking about investments in community violence intervention. He comes to this work, honestly, by listening to communities for many, many years and understanding personally that trauma and recognizing that others are experiencing trauma. That, I think, is the kind of leadership we need to have at every level. We need leaders like Mayor Scott, who are talking boldly about the opportunity to pull agencies together to data-driven, scaled. I think these are a really, really critical piece, and that we hold our leaders accountable for the vision they set. And that means voting, right? And so I want to make sure that, you know, at the backdrop of all of this is having an engaged citizenry who says we get to vote on elected officials who are leaders who then continue to appoint those. So that backdrop, I think, is critical. And to the extent that we have organizations that do that advocacy work, it's to engage people
people, to wake them up, ensure that they see the opportunity in their leaders to see change in their communities, and that they actually take action, like to make sure our democracy continues to thrive.
Yeah, I would just echo around leadership. You know, we have to lift up, you know, leadership like, you know, Director Rodriguez, you know, Ambassador Rice. I think that, you know, the charge that they've been leading around around like the White House Community Violence Intervention Collaborative, but also, you know, racial equity work, I mean, you know, immigration, like, have been really powerful. And we need to see more of this in the media. Again, and it's similarly with, you know, with Mayor Scott. We need Mayor Scott on CNN, on MSNBC. We need him in more kind of key places, like sharing out, you know, the work that he's doing in Baltimore. It's important. And then there's a couple of other pieces that I would also add is universal basic income, mm-hmm. right? We need to expand that in across the country, because believe it or not, a lot of the violence that is happening in communities because people are starving and poor and broke. You know, the whole bottom of the black market has been snatched out, so people ain't making no money hustling out here no more. Nope. You know, so what used to, you know, folks would get a pass for, you know, running off with some dope or with somebody money for $250, now to get you shot in the neighborhood. This is just real, you know, in terms of what happens on the ground. We need more emergency relocation dollars, because when we're doing that, yes, safety planning in the hospital,
that's right,
after that teachable moment, and we need to make sure that we get Raheem transferred,
that's
out.
Right.
We don't always have the resources and the places to,
that's
be able,
right,
to put them. So we got to get more strategic,
right,
partnerships with big developers, you know, who are building, you know, housing developments all across the country. But also we need to work on the policy pieces around that. OD response, right? You know, we have a crisis that's happening across the country that is also creating violence on the ground in neighborhoods. We need more, you know, like harm reduction that's happening in the cities, non-law enforcement responses to OD. You know, there's a whole like kind of system that's happening. I know we're doing it right now in Newark, in terms of training community health workers, embedding them with EMS so that they actually respond. Because even though there's a Good Samaritan law in place, right, and law enforcement is not arresting folks, you know, when folks are ODing, people are still afraid to call them because the cops know the folks who are hustling. And so you show up, man, and they're like, yo, that's pokey, man. That's hustling. And so I might arrest them even though I know that, you know, one of the folks is you know, is ODing there, right? And so people are still afraid to call. And I think that that it's important that we do that. And then, you know, one final thing is Build Back Better.
Yeah.
We got to pass Build Back Better, you know, because the funds are invested or embedded in that. And so, you know, we need more comm strategies and everything in order to make sure that people really understand the impact of Build Back Better and how it can actually benefit, you know, communities on the ground all across the country.
I'd like to open it up for questions. Please wait for the mic to reach you.
Okay, I'm gonna do this real quick because it's already 2:00. Hi, I'm Deborah Bailey from the Afro. And so this is really to all the panelists and especially to my mayor. Knowing this wonderful strategy and what happens when in communities like our own and other communities across the street, when the very workers that you're sending out into the community to make the difference are themselves targeted, as has happened in Baltimore, and then the community, then the wider community, then begins to become very afraid, and they pull back, and then they want to sort of say, oh, well, maybe this doesn't work, because the very workers who are out there making the difference are targeted.
Mayor Scott.
I'll start, and thank you, ma'am. Good to see you, as always. I'll say what I said when we, in Baltimore, we've lost three violence intervention workers over the past year and a police officer through violence in this past year. What I say often is what my brother Dante Barksdale, because
yes,
Dante was a brother to
yes
me.
Yes.
When someone said, well, Dante got killed trying to intervene in violence, does that mean that we should stop Safe Streets? I say Dante would say hell no. He would say, Brandon, you have to go further, you got to go deeper. It's more important because to honor him and everybody that we lost, that we go further. But it does mean that we have to push and evolve. So for right now, we are trying to work through issues with the state and our federal partners to allow intervention workers to wear vests, right? We have to do that. See if we have to have other enhanced training. But stopping the work is absolutely not an option. And as I said to a certain press outlet last week, when they asked me about, well, why aren't you guys going to stop safe streets because you've had three of them shot? And I said, with all due respect and uplifting of the true hero that she was, I said, you guys didn't ask me that last month when Officer Holly died. You didn't say, should we stop policing because she was shot on the job? It's no different. They are both crime fighters. They are both lifesavers, and we have to honor all of them, police, violence intervention workers, each and every day, by furthering the work, not shying away from it, because we know and they know. And then we have to evolve too in how we hold them up. We're also challenged my team to looking at how we can have our violence intervention workers and their families see line of duty things just like our police officers, right? Because they're putting their lives on the line in the same exact way.
Since we're running a little short on time, I'd like to move to the next question. And if you have something you want to add to that one, you can do it in your next response.
Hi, thank you guys so much for doing this. My name is Courtney Subramanian. I'm with USA Today. You guys have talked a lot about solutions today and shifting the narrative that this is about an ecosystem working like in the broader context of with police officers. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how you shift the narrative from a public standpoint, particularly when you have sort of these external forces, political forces, we'll say, trying to shape the narrative as a binary choice. You either support police or you don't. And like one thing I think we heard from the president yesterday, and he's been forced to repeatedly do this, is come out and say that it's not defund, does not support defund the police, that this is part of a broader strategy. And I think it's sort of where the public sentiment is sort of underscores some of the delays or hesitations we're seeing on the Hill with legislation, with police reform, with Build Back Better, and how you sort of shift public attitudes about some of these solutions that you guys are pursuing, that cities we've seen be successful like with, and particularly not just within the last couple of years. Like, this has been an ongoing thing. These solutions have been pursued for years. So that's a very long and rambling way of asking about how you shift sort of the public narrative about the conversation around combating violence and violence intervention.
Greg, maybe you wanna take
I would
that?
Love to. No, I think the first major step is that we really need the public and frankly the media to understand that this is a public health crisis. You know, the president himself and leaders all over the country, from Senator Schumer to Speaker Pelosi, have all echoed that message. But the challenge is, when it gets to the media, we keep pivoting back to a crime approach or a crime narrative. And even me personally, you know, when I was shot, my media coverage, I was looked at as a criminal first and a victim second. Every incident of violence we're seeing in our communities, we're being dehumanized consistently by the media. They show imagery of police cars and shell casings and yellow tape, but overlook the human side of this. And when you look at any major mass shooting or suicide or incident or accidental shooting, you hear the stories of the victims, the stories of pain and trauma. When it comes to Black and Brown communities, it's being framed as a crime. And so we need one, everyone, especially the media, to see this for the crisis that it is and start to balance out their coverage. And then second, we need the media to start humanizing the stories. And once you start hearing the stories of why violence is happening and how it led to that moment, then we'll start to see that this is broader than just law enforcement, that this is broader than just what you can do with a mass incarceral approach. And so I really think the way that we shift it is very simple. It's understanding and amplifying that this is a public health crisis and starting to humanize and tell the stories of the people who are being impacted, why violence is happening, and most importantly, the people who are doing the work every day.
I want to enhance that. Greg said it so beautifully. There is insufficient coverage. We don't really get into the human story of what the problem is and what the solution is. Dante Barksdale, truly a hero in Baltimore, had a national profile in his voice and his work. Frontline violence intervention professionals across the country came out when they found out what happened to Dante, because this work is so deeply rooted in people's lived experience. And I don't think America knows that there are people among them who are willing to put their life on the line to keep their community safe without any weapon, right? By using their words and their heart, sharing the experiences they had. I think that is a story that needs to be shared, and that they are effective at doing it. That they are effective, that they can actually reduce violence by 20%, 30%, 50%, 70%. They can reduce violence through these strategies. I think that anyone, right, who can see very clearly those numbers and see the power of this work would want that, would ask for it in their communities. Say, I want more of that. We want people who are in their community to say, you know what, I want to be that when I grow up, right? As a profession is honored, I think in all, we are working actually to have Medicaid reimburse for this work. Doctors and nurses, right? These healthcare professionals, if it's a healthcare issue, the healthcare professionals, you know, during COVID, they were applauded, right, going down the street because people saw their work on the front lines. I want that treatment for our violence prevention professionals.
I also want to just add about this question of, you know, when an officer is shot, you know, we fall back on training, that we need to make sure that our officers have more training. The agency that I launched, the Community-Based Public Safety Collective, put out a report in September that looked at the national standards and practices for community-based public safety work. Now, you know, we used to call it gang intervention and, you know, credible messengers. Those are components of community-based public safety. And so there is a comprehensive training that takes place. I just came back from Baltimore literally last night. Baton Rouge. The Professional Community Intervention Training Institute that was developed by Dr. Akil Bashir is one of the best training institutes in the country. Scenario-based training so that individuals are operating with standard operating procedures and protocols. It's one of the things that allows us to have a significant relationship with law enforcement in Newark. Right? When this training has been so comprehensive and important, you know, to the ecosystem of safety in Newark, that when we do the training in the city, over 100 individuals from across the city and from across the state actually participates in it. You know, it's important that folks are trained and trained in these conflict resolution strategies, and that so that as we're engaging folks in the field, we fall to our training as opposed to our conditioning. The other thing I would add is that these are public safety professionals. We have to pay them well.
That's right.
Right? So we're paying these individuals like pennies in many cases. And when they die in the field, you know, they don't have pensions, you know? Like if we're going to honor the work in the profession, then we need to make sure that we take care of folks. Because I tell you this, folks in the streets are going to have more intelligence than law enforcement will ever have in terms of what happens on the ground. Right? And so it's dangerous in some cases in neighborhoods, right? That 2% is, you know, many of them are suffering from real mental health issues that go unaddressed and that are allowed to fester. And so we need to have folks that have significant relationships, that can intervene, that can engage in conversation, that can support them in receiving the proper therapy and healing modalities, support that they need while they're intervening in terms of reducing, you know, the incidence of retaliation with conflicts.
And lastly, I would just add, because everyone's already put a bow on it, but I'm going to try to put the wrapping on the box.
All right.
I think that for and not for you, but for members of the media in particular, the same way when something like this happens and some mayor, some police chief, some violence intervention site, when a violent act of violence happened, and they say, well, what are you going to do to stop it? And why didn't you stop it? Right? With that same vigor, that same wanting an immediate answer, the same things need to be asked for those folks who don't get asked why they don't support this work, right? Because the reality is, when you're talking about an incident that happened in someone's home or happened in someone's car or happened inside of some establishment, police weren't going to be able to stop it. Yes. We have to also, and that could be something that is done, train media folks to understand the work so that they can ask better and more informed questions. Yes. Because public safety, violence in our country has evolved, but we are still operating off this outdated playbook that, hey, when an act of violence happened, the first thing you should ask is, why didn't the police stop it, right? Mm-hmm. And we had a very unfortunate incident where a 66-year-old woman, 60-year-old woman was killed inside a church, and a particular media outlet, you can guess which one it is, said, well, why didn't the police stop it? And I said, in what world do you think we're going to have police officers inside a church bathroom? That's just not going to happen. And we have to understand that in a very deep way and really stop falling to this way that our culture is going and that everything is going to be immediate, because it's not. They're not going to immediately have the understanding of why someone did that. But also, we have to push ourselves to understand that this isn't an either or. You didn't hear anyone up here today say there aren't things that we should be doing, and we outline things that are done each and every day. But we also have to understand that if we don't want to be having the same conversation 37 years from now, like we're having right now, then we have to invest. Because the truth is, we could with a straight face say, well, why do we disagree with those who say we should just only focus on policing? Because it hasn't worked, right? I'm 37 years old. They've operated the same way every year, and that conversation's been had every single day I've taken breath.
We're going to have to stop there, but if you have additional questions, I'm sure you can find the panelists outside. And for now, please join me in thanking our panelists for such a rich discussion.